We are going to shift the conversation a little bit about Hemingway. I don't know if anyone out there has been obsessed with the PBS documentary that is on right now. Jennifer Tynan with us. She's an English teacher, but you're also with the Michigan Hemingway Society. It's great to have you with us.
Thank you very much.
Have you been watching the documentary?
Oh, yes.
What a fascinating life that he lived, and just a master with words.
I think that my favorite quote from the documentary was when Tobias Wolff said that he changed all the furniture in the room when it came to writing. And I think that that captures his impact on American literature perfectly.
So tell us more about the Michigan Hemingway Society, though, before we jump into Hemingway's life.
Oh, well, our focus is on bringing attention and awareness to the impact that Michigan's boyhood summers had on Hemingway's life and fiction, especially the Nick Adams stories, which I think definitely was in the first segment of the Hemingway documentary on PBS, but is often overlooked. And, you know, it carries with him throughout his life, and it carries with him throughout his fiction. Even in the later years in A Movable Feast, he comes back to those Michigan summers.
So it could be these boyhood adventures that fuel and help spark some of our journeys through life. With that, we're speaking with Jennifer Tynan. She's an English teacher at West Bloomfield High School, but also the secretary for the Michigan Hemingway Society. What is it about his work that so fascinates you?
First of all, I'm an enormous fan of his short stories, but there's something special about the Nick Adams stories that, you know, really transcends. I'm sorry to be so inarticulate. I've been teaching.
I'm like that many days, but I had an extra dose of caffeine today, so
I probably should have done the same. What's really interesting is that teaching here at West Bloomfield High School, you know, I have a cross section of kids that it looks like I'm looking out over the United Nations, and so kids come from all kinds of backgrounds and all kinds of you know, places and religions and ethnicities and races. And what's interesting about teaching these stories is that, you know, when I'm teaching the end of something, for instance, where Nick institutes a breakup with a girl, it's fascinating because everybody in the room has had a crush on someone. Everybody in the room knows somebody. If they haven't experienced it themselves, then they've helped a friend through that situation. They've either been the one who's instituted the breakup, or they've comforted somebody who has been the one who's been broken up with. And so they all find that universality in those stories. And then when you set it in Michigan, and you set it in the woods, and you set it in nature, and you set it in, there's a picnic, and there's a rowboat, and there's water. There's something about that natural world and about summers in Michigan that every kid in the classroom can relate to. And so that's, I think, the magic of those stories, is that it's chronicling so many of those moments that are universal, whether you live in Michigan or not, that are universal to our human experience.
So with that, Jennifer, as a teacher, do you think because he has that connection to Michigan, it makes it, or at least gives you a thread in order to connect your students to his work and what's possible out there?
Yes, I mean, they are stunned to find out, maybe not next year so much, but up until now, they are always stunned to find out that such a famous author has such a close connection to Michigan when they read the names of Petoskey or Horton Smee or, you know, seeing, they find out that he's writing about the UP. What canonical author is writing about the Upper Peninsula of Michigan and talking about the best place to go trout fishing? And then when I tell them that he actually hid the name of the river because he didn't, and used a different river's name because he wanted to protect his special trout fishing spot, they're even more blown away because they can't believe that he would have such intimate knowledge of the Upper Peninsula of Michigan to do that.
I love that you use those little tidbits about his life to engage your students, because those are the little facts that they will remember for years to come.
Oh, and they, you know, they want, if they haven't been there already, they want to go. And if they have been, they want to go back and find all, there are many markers that the Michigan Hemingway Society has established plaques that that tie to Hemingway's connections to different places, not just in Petoskey, but Kalkaska and Seney and just around, that they can look at and that they can you know, do their own walking tour. They're detailed on the Michigan Hemingway Society website. So they want to go see those places. They want to go find them themselves. And I think that that's a really visceral connection for them.
It helps spark a new adventure, because we may see something with one set of eyes, but then we gain this knowledge and you go back and you revisit it. And it's a different journey then.
Yes, for sure. For sure. And the other thing is that it's not in a story that I teach in the classroom because it's too risque, but he mentions mint in one of the stories, and I have a literary garden here at the high school. We have mint from Horton's Bay in the literary garden that we grow here, but they can also go up to Horton's Bay and see where the actual mint grows, and they find that connection really fascinating. In 2017, I took just over 50 students up to Petoskey, and we did a tour with our president, with the Michigan Hemingway Society president, and they too got to plunge their hands into this creek and you know, smell the mint and do all of the things around Petoskey, see the different places, go to the Little Traverse Historical Museum, and for them, being in what we call Hemingway country really immersed them into that experience in a way that, you know, even though we have the mint in the garden, it was a very literary immersive experience that, you know, I was so happy that we were able to do that. I'm hoping that we can do it again once the pandemic passes.
Oh, that, you know, because those are experiences that will live with some of your students for so long. And with that, you just mentioned the garden. Tell us more about that.
Well, I had an idea several years back that I'm a huge literary tourist. I mean, just it's literary rock stardom to me to go to different places and to visit the homesteads and museums of where these authors lived and worked. And so many of them were inspired by the nature around them. And I had this idea, the courtyard at that point, I'm looking over it right now, but the courtyard at that point was really underdeveloped. And so I asked our principal at the time, you know, would I be able to develop that and perhaps get some plants from, if I could, you know, that perhaps grew at these spots, maybe even when the authors were there. And I was surprised at the success that I had. Emily Dickinson, we have Harrison's yellow rosebush that that Dr. Jane Eberwein, who is a professor emeritus from Oakland University, thinks that Emily Dickinson tended to when she was alive at Amherst, in Amherst at her house there. We have a lilac bush that comes from the old manse in Concord when Nathaniel Hawthorne was renting from Ralph Waldo Emerson, and he wrote about it in an essay called Buds and Bird Voices. Edie Vonnegut let me come to her house and dig up hydrangeas that Kurt Vonnegut had tended to. And so we've been tremendously fortunate to get these plants from these different authors and bring a sense of place through these plants to the garden and have the kids feel a visceral connection to these authors in that way.
So I'm guessing you spend your vacations searching out these, if I can offer one in North Carolina. I lived in North Carolina. Charles Kuralt, his burial
spot. Yes, oh yes, yep. I was a journalism major before I was in, I was in journalism before I was a teacher, so yep.
They really do just open up your world, because you know what? It makes you connect to a person as a human instead of what we build them up to be as superstars, because we see the end of the career, not the beginning. And so many of these amazing writers in our lifetime and beyond, the authors, they really did come from simple backgrounds many times. So with that too, when you're talking to your students, how do you get them to be engaged in this world when there's all about online right now?
Well,
exploring books.
I will tell you, back, it's so prescient, and I had no idea, obviously, that I didn't know the pandemic was coming, but I was bucking that online trend and feeling like kids were spending too much time on their devices pre-pandemic. And then, the last year has obviously borne that out in ways I could have never predicted. But now it's funny, when the kids came back, we were remote in the fall, but they were allowed to come back and work on the garden because it was one of the few clubs that we had at the school that we could social distance, that we were outdoors. And so for the first couple of months, we were able to clean up the garden and to do the necessary things. And it had been neglected, from the previous fall. And so we were able to do a cleanup. Then we were shut down. Then we came back in January. And so this spring, we've been working to clean it up again. And the kids are delighted. We actually have a meeting coming up on Earth Day this Thursday. And there are more kids that are interested in being outside, and they don't want to be trapped indoors. They don't want to be on their devices. And so we're seeing some more interest in doing that, and they want to get their hands dirty, and they want to be in a club that allows them a lot of interdisciplinary activities. I mean, you can be out there and talk about what author you'd want to see in the garden. You can be out there and talk about, well, what does the soil need? We've done soil samples with our AP environmental science class, and what can we do to replenish the soil? Because the garden's 6 years old now, and we really need to think about what to do with that. How are we going to water it over the summer? What's the best way to do that, the most environmentally sound way to do that? And so the kids are thinking in different ways, non-native plants, native plants. Kurt Vonnegut's hydrangeas are blue on the East Coast. They turn pink here because of the soil composition. Do we want to change that composition, or do we like that they come in pink? Things like that to talk about, and what plants are working for us in terms of teaching, what plants do they have no connection with, but are still historical and could be moved elsewhere on campus to invite the public in, perhaps that we could take out of the courtyard and put, in other places that are more accessible.
It's about engaging the students in different ways. Jennifer Tynan with us here on the MegaCast. She's an English teacher and the secretary for the Michigan Hemingway Society. With that, we do know, though, Hemingway, as so many great writers, lived a very troubled life as well. How do you try to share that story and that side of his life with your students as well? I know that you only have a few minutes because you have to get to class, but...
The story of my life. One of the things that the Mint, for instance, at the beginning of Summer People is talked about in a baptismal sense, as though Hemingway is trying to talk about Nick Adams in a way of cleansing himself, that it's, we talk about the ways mint is used in products as refreshing and cleansing and cooling, right? And that he's trying to purge himself of impure thoughts, right? So it's interesting that Mint keeps coming up in a couple of the Nick Adams stories. The hydrangeas are not even mentioned in any of Kurt Vonnegut's tales. But one of the things that I've talked about with different Kurt Vonnegut scholars is that he tended to them, and I think that this is true, as a way of rebirth and growth after all of the horrors that he saw during World War II and after the mental health struggles that he struggled with and the family history. He and Hemingway actually have a legacy of family mental health issues. And so you see that Vonnegut found gardening as a way of coping with mental health. And that research is borne out too for us during the pandemic. Look at how we coped last spring, and the run on seeds and the run on victory gardens and the run on that as a coping mechanism to deal with the mental health and stress of the pandemic. So it's really interesting to learn from some of these authors and what we can do to try and cope when things get difficult and make different choices in a lot of cases.
Connections and life lessons to be learned. Thank you again, Jennifer Tynan, with us here. She's the English teacher at West Bloomfield High School, but also the secretary for the Michigan Hemingway Society. We know you have to run to class, but we so appreciate your time.
Thank you so much for having me.